Hello, friends, and welcome back to Stories About Entitled People. In the first story, we tell you about a horrible manager who tried to ruin the life of a team of professionals. I think you guessed it didn't work out. But before we begin, don't forget to subscribe to our channel if you're new here and turn on notifications so you don't miss a new video every single day. Here we go. Competent and present management. I work at a large engineering company in internal IT development. I and my three immediate coworkers had been with the company for 10 years or more, and we managed a complex software system that we built from the ground up over the course of these 10 years. Needless to say, we didn't take lightly to uppity middle managers who had ideas, but no clue. Just after one of the frequent mergers slash takeovers slash name changes so endemic in our business, we were transferred to a new middle manager. At first, she seemed enthusiastic and interested in our work, but it soon appeared that she was completely clueless and it was impossible to teach her anything about what we were actually doing. She was like a scrambler. You put in clear and simple words, but out came pure nonsense. The same with information from upper management. After being filtered through her, it was impossible to understand what the information was supposed to be. She soon learned to dislike the four of us. We talked back to her, we told her she was plain wrong, we told her to shut up and listen. She was manager of about 30 people and we were the only ones who did this. So naturally, we were the difficult ones. Well, yes, we absolutely were difficult. On the top of everything, she was based in an office 500 kilometers away and was doing micromanagement by telephone. Needless to say, our non-compliance with her nonsense was ripe and pungent, and one day she hired an external consultant to analyze what was wrong with us. She was screaming over the phone that we better do as the guy said and talk to him or we would regret it. So we did. We talked to the guy at length. Consultant guy was actually a great guy. He came in believing we were a dysfunctional group that he had to write a report on to underpin disciplinary action. After two full days of discussions, he left with a report that pinpointed pretty exactly where the problem really was. We never saw that report. We never heard from anybody about that report. But 2 weeks later, there was a reorganization and my group was transferred to a local middle manager. To explain the sudden reorganization, upper management came and held a PowerPoint party. Mostly it was the usual drivel about how the new organization would increase productivity and make a leaner organization, and how we were such marvelous employees. But sandwiched in there was one sentence: highly skilled workers such as here at X Company deserve competent and present managers. I believe that came from the forgotten report. I'm just jealous that you appear to have competent upper management who, one, actually read the consultant's report instead of just listening to the middle manager's spin on it, and two, was able to admit they made a mistake in the first reorg. And our second story. I just wanted my $52 back. This was 7-ish years ago in upstate New York. I had just moved there for graduate school and knew no one. The first place I lived was with my roommates I found on Craigslist. This was the first place I'd ever rented in my life with my name on the lease, where I was essentially responsible for myself. The roommates I had were damn shady and the place was a wreck, but cheap at least. I made a few friends in the first couple of months, and by about November, they were talking about finding places for the following year, which is common in a lot of college towns. Three of my friends found a place together, so I decided to find a place with my two other friends. We'll call them Pat and Dora. We look around a bit and end up finding a place a few houses down from our other three friends and sign the lease in late November. Like lots of the housing in this area, it's a house with two apartments, one upstairs, us, and one downstairs. We later found out four undergrads and a shared basement slash garage. The landlord seemed pretty swell too. Included in our rent are snow removal and water, heat, power, and internet or not. In this area, especially, this is common as heat's expensive. Also, chatting with the landlord about this, he explains to us that to have separate billing for multi-unit housing, you have to have separate meters for each unit. Legally, he goes on to say for this, that most properties, this is pretty easy to do for electric, but a lot harder and expensive to do with water, which is why most places, multi-unit places, include water. The school year comes and goes, and we move in at the beginning of June, no problems. Toward the end of August, our landlord calls and tells us he's selling the place. Not to worry, though, our lease is still good, of course. And the new guy owns some properties already. Cool, whatever. We get the new address to send the check to. The new landlord seems fine. We call in October about a power outlet not working. He gets it fixed. He's good about snow removal. No real problems. Also, he's from New Zealand. Tells us he owns a dozen or so properties in the area. We barely interact with the downstairs neighbors. They're all right for undergrads, and over the course of the year, we only have a half dozen interactions where we need to ask them to keep it down because it's 4 a.m. on a Wednesday, or ask to let someone out who's parked in. Notable is that the school we're talking about here is fairly expensive, and most of the undergrads come from backgrounds with a fair amount of money. You'd need to in order to afford this school, or take out a heap of loans. Downstairs neighbors have really nice cars and a lot of nice stuff in the garage. Seems like they come from money. They also let us have their beer bottles and cans to recycle, which is really nice of them, and nets like 10 to 20 bucks a week. The school year comes and goes, we move out. I move out first, over Memorial Day, since I'm working in Asia for the summer, and then moving out of state. I don't see the place again, but ask roommates to clean well enough so we get some of the deposit back. I don't figure this out until later, but it seems that every interaction with the landlord is something he stretches to the absolute limit of what he's allowed. 30 days, 2 weeks, whatever. I leave for Asia in early July, email Pat and Dora about if they've received their deposits back. I gave my parents' address as forwarding. They had, and Dora sends me a scan of it. Going through, we each lost $70 for cleaning and damage, and there goes a bill for $52 for the water bill. I don't know how they left it, so maybe it took $70 to clean. So it goes. I remember that water was included in the rent. I bring this up with both of them, which they remember as well. I email landlord and mention this to him. At this point, I assume he maybe has a different setup at other properties and made an honest mistake. Accidents happen. I hear back from the landlord 2 weeks later. He asked to see a copy of the lease. Reflecting on this, I assume he thought I wouldn't have access to one since I was in Asia. I have Dora and Pat scan me the lease, mail him a copy, and email it to him. I hear back 2 weeks later, he says he'll send us the money. By the time I get the money, it's late August and I'm home from Asia. Yay, I get my $52 back. Talking to Dora and Pat a few weeks later, Pat had just gotten engaged and was Skyping the whole old crew. I found out neither one of them had gotten their $52. At this point, I was pissed. Clearly, that was not an honest mistake. Landlord assumed I didn't talk to them and that they wouldn't find out. Pat and Dora are pissed. I'm pissed. We dig out the contract information from the undergrads who live downstairs and let them know what's up. We also let the current residents know what happened since we happen to have the contact info for some of them. We write them an email and I provide copies of all of my emails with landlord and the lease. I hear from Pat and Dora, and they got their money back 30 days later, and that landlord was a jerk about it. I don't think about it for a long time, even though I'm still in touch with Pat and Dora. About 2 years after this happens, I get an email from a law firm asking if I used to live at old address and if landlord was my landlord. I reply yes, and they ask to speak on the phone. Law firm belongs to one of the undergrad's dad. This is how he could afford expensive schooling. Through the course of the conversation, it comes out that Dad was really angry about this, that someone would try to take advantage of his son. He has the time and resources to go scorched earth on the landlord. Dad brings a case against the landlord and has his people comb through all of the landlord's records, former tenants, etc. As it turns out, he's been scamming people like this for quite a while. Pertinent here also was the fact that he didn't have the separate water meters. The lawyer explains to me that because of this, landlord is facing jail time. He apparently did enough of this, and they were able to provide evidence for it, that it rose to the level of some more serious crap like a criminal case over a civil one, I think. On top of this, I'm getting my $70 back, and so are Dora and Pat as part of some settlement deal. Landlord might have to sell his properties. The kicker is that, as it turns out, landlord's legal status could be in jeopardy because of this being a serious crime. Again, I don't really remember the particulars and don't know if this lawyer was exaggerating. I really just wanted my $52 back for the water bill. And our last story. Put our company into debt? Your vacation, job, and relationship will be destroyed. Company background. Tiny IT consultancy with four workers. Because there were only four of us, we all had multiple roles. The a-hole in question was our salesman slash finance manager. He had full control over the company finances. We were apparently doing well, so everything was good. He was also the type of person who initially was very likable, but after a week of working with him, you would realize that he was a smarmy and greedy C-word. He was also a longtime friend of the company owner, which explains why he was given so much trust. To start with, he would turn up at work at around lunchtime and have constant meetings using the company credit card, which were no more than him treating his friends to lunch. But due to his friendship with the owner and the fact that we were making money, this was overlooked. Eventually, he decided to take his girlfriend on vacation. He was really into her, but she was very high maintenance and the relationship was very rocky. The vacation was designed to fix their relationship and impress her. So a few days into his vacation, we needed to quote someone for a few workstations and needed to find the relevant paperwork, so I took a look at the huge pile of paper on his desk. I found the relevant paperwork, but I also found a letter demanding we pay our overdue rent, and then another demand and another. Then I found credit card bills detailing exactly how much he'd been treating his girlfriend and friends on the company credit card. So I collected all of this information, walked into the owner's office, and gave it all to him. He was almost in tears when he saw our true financial situation. We were effed. He phoned up the credit card company to check for recent payments and found that his vacation flights were also paid for with the company credit card, so the owner immediately had that card canceled. A few days later, we had an emergency call from a foreign number. He was very confused because he just needed to borrow a little money from the company credit card in order to pay his hotel bill, but the card was being declined. The result of that call was that he was told he was fired and that he won't be getting any more funds from that card. Also, the owner filed charges against him. He had to beg his girlfriend for her credit card to pay for the hotel. She paid it, but dumped him shortly afterwards when she came to our company to find out what happened and realize what an a-hole he'd been. Hey guys, thank you all for watching the video. I'll see you in the next one.